right now, though, like we said, we do have our first match underway, or getting ready underway, Koi Boys versus the Bozos. We already have our map fans. We did have that video just before the stream started, talking about how the entire series is going to work. Of course, each team is going to start it off with the band phase. And this is our map pool right now. Flak Fort, Underground Command Center, Thermal Plant, Mountain R&D, Quarry, Ministry of Defense, and Harbor City. Only the 7 maps will be played throughout today. We'll see how many of them actually make it through the band phases. Each team gets 1 ban at the initial stage. This is best of 3, so we're only going to be playing best of 3 until the grand finals, which is going to be a best of 5. But our first ban is going to be on Thermal Plant. So that's, I hate to see that, because Thermal Plant is actually one of my favorite maps.
Well, you know, one thing I think we need to talk about, right? Of course, this game is very, very new. It's within, I think, just a little bit under 2 months old. So for anybody out there who isn't as familiar with the game, one of the unique things here is that there are 3 different game types all within the current legal map pool. There's Destruction, which is you're trying to destroy essentially bombs, several bombs in a place or in a single map. Then there's Point Capture, where you're capturing points, pretty self-explanatory. And then there's Domination, which is a lot less of like progressing through a map and a very much a smaller map where you fight for points one at a time, and you both kind of spawn on opposite sides of pretty much symmetrical maps. And that is what we do see out of Thermal Plant. I like Thermal Plant a lot too. I think that the really interesting thing that we're going to see today is we're going to see, based on what map type they end up playing, we're going to see very different team comps. Like, for example, Thermal Plant, of course, we're not going to see it, but I think it does tend to really work better for a lot of the shorter range, yeah, kind of like flankers that maybe you don't want quite as many when you're kind of pushing down long sites, but I do like seeing that and the chaos that ensues.
Yeah, definitely would be like more brawler heavy, right? We're going to have our Exia's, Barbados's, of course. Right now, though, I think Exia is just going to be a staple across whatever map type, whether it's Point Capture, Domination, or Destruction, along with Dom. Those two seem to be the most staple. And speaking of our mobile suits, right now, we do have the Melee Zaku currently in the quarantine. We will go ahead and revisit that, but the admins decided, because there is a pretty substantial bug with it, we're just not going to have it in pool, just for competitive integrity for the most part. But going back to compositions, depending upon the bans, it looks like our first map pick is actually going to be on Flak Fort. And that's going to be interesting, because point A is one of those points for Flak Fort where we're more than likely going to be seeing the offensive side starting it off with something like maybe a GM sniper.
Yeah, that's, I mean, kind of similar to what I was saying. Even just aside from seeing very different comps and very different suits within different game modes based on the map, also just the map themselves, right? There are maps, like you were saying, Flak Fort starts off, there are a lot of A's, A points in particular on like Point Capture that just have really, really long sights. For example, like Harbor City is maybe one of the biggest examples of that. I'm not sure if we're going to see too much Harbor City today, but yeah, Flak Fort, another great example of that. And then I think don't see as many super ridiculous snipers quite yet. We see a lot of people that are playing a lot of the more up close suits. Of course, like you said, Exia is extremely strong right now. We're seeing we saw a lot of Zaku 2 at a point. Of course, there's been a patch since then. Still, like you said, there's the bug. But we've seen a lot of like these kind of like more death ball-y comps. But the snipers, I mean, that is such a strong suit if you can aim really well. And I mean, the heads are pretty big in this game. It's not like it's going to be super hard to land a lot of headshots. But having somebody who is really, really dedicated to that role is difficult, because you do get maps like, for example, a lot of the Domination maps where you can't always easily just have your sniper on your team. So I'm really excited to see who we're going to see pop off with a sniper, if anybody. I know there's been a few people, but I'm not sure how much we'll see of them.
Yeah, I mean, for Flak Fort, I think it might just be on the offensive side, opening up with Jim Sniper and then swapping immediately. Maybe you get a pick if you don't, and they kind of retreat back into point A. You can go ahead and at least know that the pressure from the sniper forces them back, opens up a little space. You make the quick swap off, and then you go for whatever regular composition you're going to have. We'll see what does kind of fill the suit of the Melee Zaku. I mean, we saw a lot of Melee Zaku in other tournaments. In the Were Force tournament, I hope I'm pronouncing it right, that just took place in China last week, there was definitely maybe an 80-90% pick rate, and then he kind of flexes off for specific maps like Flak Fort, where you do are where you're probably going to want to open up with things like snipers. So we'll see. But again, I'm kind of glad to see that we do have the kind of competitive quarantine right now for Melee Zaku, just to open up compositions, maybe create some space for things Create some space for things like Ashimar. I think Ashimar is fantastic when it comes to Flak Fort just because of the opening that he can create with a punch, or just being able to back line, get and hold teams back to point A or even to point B. So this is going to be interesting to see how teams do end up kind of exploring this. So right now we're just waiting for game one to get underway. This is the winner's quarterfinals. We're only going to be streaming one of those matches before we move on to the winner's semifinals.
Yeah, and again, just a huge shout out to the production for making this all happen. You know, this is we still don't quite have the observer mode yet. You know, we're hoping for one very soon, but we are just going to be taking a lot of these player perspectives, which is not the easiest thing to do. So, of course, we just want to give a huge thank you to everybody who is in the Gundam Evolution Newtype League and running everything, because it is not, again, the easiest thing to do. But I'm just really glad that we get anything right now, right? Just to be able to see any action at all. And a big thank you to all of the teams who signed up. And of course, aside from supporting the tournament, are streaming their own POVs just so that we can have this great gameplay for the future, for everybody who wants to get into the game or everybody who wants to get better at the game. This is going to be such a good example of it. But I'm really curious what the other ban was on this set. I think I saw in the chat a little bit, but I think what teams ban which modes is really telling of kind of like how their comps go. You were talking earlier about like what the common picks are, and I do think that we pretty much have... We have some solidified options right now. Like, we're still seeing a lot of Sazabees because there's not a lot of other tank options. We do see just normal Jim that does have a shield, but I haven't seen how really people are feeling about it post a lot of the recent buff, where it got a little bit more range on shots and a little bit more speed on the firebomb. But generally, you know, we're seeing a lot of Sazabee, we were seeing a lot of Exia. I think we're probably going to see on pretty much every single team here. We might have seen Zaku's, but like you said, no Zaku's. Aside from that, though, maybe like Methuses or a Unicorn. There does tend to be a little bit of like a support role on the team, but how the team decides to use that is usually pretty different. Unicorn trying to go a little bit more for like the group pushing. Methus is really a lot better at like kind of split pushing or going over certain walls with certain other options. So we could see some different comps, even if there are some somewhat similar roles. For anybody who's not familiar, you're not role locked at all in this. There are no actual like literal roles, so you could go with the weirdest comp in the entire world. You can't repeat suits, but it's still not always the smartest choice, of course, to go for the weirdest comp.
Yeah. So quick little update. So it seemed like one of the teams wasn't very aware that there was a map pool. So we do have the 7 map pool, like you can see at the bottom of the screen right now. So they redid their bans. They actually tried to ban out Missile Base, which isn't in the pool. Oh. And so they ended up banning Ministry of Defense. So one destruction map gone, and then one hardpoint map gone as well for a thermal plant. And so we're going to be starting it off in 2CP essentially in capture with Flak Fort. And so again, nothing changes there. But like you said, you brought up Unicorn. Unicorn does kind of slot in as the secondary support as well, just having armor on cooldown, team wide armor as well. And pretty impactful, I would say, ultimate. Just the long range snipes that you're afforded with it. It's what I love about this game so far for Gundam Evolution is just that, like, even though there are the roles, you have your tanks, you have your DPS, and you have your supports. As a support, you don't feel like you're a hard stuck support. But all you're doing is just kind of right clicking on something, right? Even Methus, even though he's healing someone, he can still be shooting, which, you know, and compared to his counterparts in another game, is much different than how you end up playing that one. So I love that you're able to do that right now. I don't know if we're gonna see as much Methus. If we do see the Sazabee, I definitely expect to see maybe double support, bring out both Gundam, both the Unicorn Gundam along with the Methus, just to keep that Sazabee kind of topped off, especially with kind of buffs that he did receive in terms of how his shotgun works now. Damage drop-off starts off a little bit further away, and you know what? He kind of needed it, I would say, just because, again, there are just so many threats to Sazabee where he could get one-shot by Exia, Barbados, everyone. It's just absolutely insane. So it can be a little bit difficult to play him, but I do want to see maybe some more Sazabees in play. Right now, though, it looks like we are set to go in just a moment for map number one. Thank you all so much at home for your patience right now. This is our first time putting on this production. We have a one-man show in behind the camera right now doing all of this. And so just shout out to Lux, of course, for doing everything he does. There's a lot going on behind the scenes. So if there is a delay, I hope and pray, of course, and thank you for your patience at home. Right now, this is the Breakout Series Halloween Havoc. While we are getting game number one set up, make sure you go ahead and check out Match Reno. That's where you can go ahead and check out all the brackets. I know that a few teams are streaming it right now as well, so you can go ahead and check out their links there as well. It should be able to link that way if they took the time to link their Twitch pages to their Match Reno account. So, and if you didn't know, you could do that. Go ahead and do that. So you guys get a little bit of traction your way. But right now, it does seem like we've got a nice little presence going on. A lot of our competitors are in our Twitch chat, so thank you guys so much for showing up and supporting. We got 76 viewers so far for our first stream ever, so I'm really excited about this.
Yeah, that's sick. Shout-outs to all of you. Super appreciated. Oh, and just so that everybody knows, of course, there is a delay just for competitive integrity, in case we didn't mention that earlier. Maybe I just didn't catch it. But, yeah, no sniping allowed. So I did mention... Oh, wait. No, maybe we don't get a chance to see that. Do we actually have our first match ready? I'm super excited to get into some Gundam, and it looks like we do. I am extremely excited. Here we go. So it looks like I'm not sure which POV we're getting. Waverwees. So I think this is the side of Koi Boys, I believe.
This is going to be Koi Boys, of course. They're starting off on the offense because the map pick... after the bans goes to the higher seed, and then you get to decide which side you want to attack with, and that is going to be the Koi Boys selecting looks like offense first. And offensively, they're not going to they're going to start it off with the Sabi, and so of course bringing that Methus is going to be great, having that single heal just to keep the tank up, because again, there's just so much long range in this game. Even though there is damage drop off on large majority of the units, that shield can get shredded instantly, and so that tank needs some extra upkeep for now.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and it looks like we can see now the other side here. We are going to see a unicorn. We're going to see, yeah, Sazabi again. Just no, I mean, no Zaku 2 melee means that Sazabi's shield has a lot more chance of surviving, I think. Oh, yeah. And we're already seeing them, oh, just getting melted on the choke. Look at that. An assist from every single person on the team. I don't even know if I've seen that before.
Yeah, this is just good target fire right now, but they are deathballing. You were calling it, right? Teams are going to try and play close together. But I like what we're seeing coming out from them right now. As they fall back, they're going to keep Duke on that high ground, try and contest them there. You can see, though, the XEs are coming out from either side, that Dom Trooper as well. So Sazabi's either side right now, but it's going to be the Unicorn. That could be the difference maker here for the offense, having a little bit more healing, for the defense to keep everyone up. We do have a knock trying to get res. They're trying to block it, but no, the Sazabi will fall down, and now Methus has to fall back, 86 HP, and it's going to be a full reset coming out from the offense.
Yeah, I do love the fact that we're seeing a unicorn there. This is a really strange choke point where there are technically different routes, but depending on where you want to hold it, how far forward you want to hold it, you can either group up or slightly split up, and it looks like they're going to be holding really, really close to the base right there and just trying to use advantage of that unicorn grouping up.
Yeah, they're continuing to challenge that high ground for now, but again, this is only a fight for the checkpoint, for the waypoint right now. You can see the BOZOS are doing an amazing job of keeping them checked and even challenged on that height. You can see the first dive on in, but they swerve on back. Jay Slay would be the first one to fall. You can see the Unicorn keeping everyone topped off right now, and that's going to be an easy cleanup now for the BOZOS, forcing them back to spawn once more. And now we're down to 3 minutes and 10 seconds. They haven't even made it to the waypoint quite yet.
Yeah, they are holding so extremely well. I was mentioning this before, but BOZOS is an extremely strong team. There was an EGL tournament very recently. They dominated the competition. We're currently looking at, I believe, the rank number one player generally in the entire world, the number one ranked new type, of course, an Exia only player, which is, I mean, when you have the rank number one player on who is maybe considered the strongest suit in the entire game. I'm sorry, we're actually looking at the other side. I got mixed right there. We're looking at the other Exia, but when we look at the other Exia, we will be seeing that player as well. So that's just one of the scariest things you could possibly see. And this team has been together for a very long time. Koi Boys, on the other hand, as like I said, a little bit of a newer team. I like trying to get over that wall, seeing if there's any target, nothing to hit. But I love the fact that they're just holding so far back. They're just not letting themselves get picked.
They have three team maneuvers now actually being used as the Ashmar Punch comes on out. That's going to be another clean wipe once again. Really good. What is it? knowledge to know that they only needed to use the two. They didn't overextend and maybe use all four of them. For the time being, though, of course, they're going to have that Unicorn Gundam Ultimate as well as the Wall Hacks just to slow things down by time again. And the Wall Hacks go down, and at this point now, the Koi Boys are going to have to wait things out as Duke goes in and gets that snipe. The Sazabi actually ends up picking up two there with the axe as he pushes forward. With that, now the Methus is going to be forced back once more. So the Koi Boys finding it extremely difficult to get past this choke.
Yeah, and we know that on the other side, there is an available Hades ult as well, which can be just one of the strongest ults in the game, even post-nerf. I mean, you do charge it slower, but the effect of it is still extremely strong, especially when you have people running through a choke point. One of these first choke points, there's only a minute and 30 left. Of course, you get a good amount of time if you do capture this checkpoint, but, or not the checkpoint, I'm sorry, the first actual point. So there's still more for them to do even after this, even if they do get the checkpoint. A lot of times, even in competitive games, we do see them already kind of moving on to the next phase of this, but I mean, we've seen like several team wipes. Everybody's just playing angles right here. Nobody's really committing to these big team fights. That was a nice push, but we are going to see the Nessus go down.
Again, though, this is two, three ultimate being, G maneuvers being used into this, but they're able to hold it down. You can see that even the Trans Am was utilized on the other side, and they forced them back once more. So just so much has been used here. And again, they haven't even been able to make it to the waypoint. Now they still have to get the bomb planted. It's 46 seconds left to go. This is basically the last push for the Koi boys here, as the Bozos are just doing an amazing job of unrelenting pressure on them. You can see once again trying to find an opening, but as a full five-man group around that unicorn is keeping everyone topped off, and see the difference in the support. When you get that unicorn, when you have the extra armor as well from that Dom Trooper to push on out, Methus is in the middle of things, but he's gonna lose his life. And now with the full team wipe, it looks like it's gonna be an end here. That just means for the Bozos on the other side, once they get onto their offense, they just have to plant the bomb, they just have to get a third, and it's gonna be game over.
Yeah, that is actually really normally very hard to defend from even just the first point, getting, you know, a singular tick in this map. You do have to really split up and decide which way you're going to defend. The angle in between both of the bomb sites on the first point here, it doesn't really give you visual to either of them. It's like right in the middle of a hallway. So you have to somewhat split up your team. I think one really strong push could just do it. And, you know, again, there are a lot of teams in this. It's a very new game. There are a lot of teams that are new to either competing. Of course, most people are new to Gundam. Some of these teams are a little bit more new to shooters in general. I'll go and, you know, go back to the survey and kind of say what they wrote down for themselves in a minute, maybe once this match is over. But this is definitely a really tough match, I do have to say. Bozos, I could see, I mean, just looking at their play right now, definitely one of the favorites to win the entire thing. They have come out on top against most of the other top seeds in this bracket. Of course, seeding is determined by your previous placements in genl tournaments. We did have the Pilots Showdown that occurred, I want to say, a few weeks ago, actually. I don't know, time is hard to keep track of anymore, but that's why they actually weren't in that. They didn't form until after that, I believe, so that's why they actually weren't seeded first or second or maybe even third. I believe we have only two of the top teams, or three from the previous tournament. So yeah, this is just an unfortunate roll of the dice. This is winner's bracket, though. It is double elimination. Regardless of what happens here, either one of these teams will have another chance.
Yeah, and I think that a Pilot Showdown was about a month ago. Time has definitely been an abstract thing the last few years, to say the least. But yeah, now we do have the Bozos on the offense. They're not really going to change anything unless they do bring in this Mahiru. And honestly, with the angles that you can get off of this, especially for that first waypoint, it could be incredibly strong. You see that there are plenty of little map geometry for you to angle things around, but it's going to be Duke trying to find that first opening for now. Three people up top, the Methus is there as well, and they want to go for that dive right now, bringing one down low. But that's enough just to at least force them back, maybe use that medkit first, and kind of allow the pressure to force them back just a bit more. But now you can see they're regrouping for this high ground take. The Methus is the first one to go down, and they were eyeing that the entire time. Duke will fall, but they find the first opening.
Yeah, and you can just see that beautiful, smooth movement from the Exia, one of the most mobile suits in the entire game. And oh my gosh, look at this. The entirety of Koi Boy is getting pushed back all the way into the hallway. It looks like the waypoint point is already captured. Now the question, is it going to be A? Is it going to be B? Both of them have different advantages and disadvantages for either attacking or defending them, either having like a vertical advantage or a long range advantage. It looks like they're going to be moving over here to B and already clearing out several people on the team, looking for that full team wipe. The Methus is going to go down right here, or maybe not.
If the Bozos want to stick to that sniper, I mean, of course, they're going to want to go for A, and it looks like Duke has cleared out this side. This team decided to push the other way. So he might just be clearing this out, but for now, it does seem like they're going to go ahead and regroup for this. The bomb plant has gone down. Never mind, it has been interrupted as he just backs away for the time of being. Here comes out the next push. Methus by himself. again will fall, but that's the kind of pressure that the Bozos are applying on the support, have to try and stall things out, but they're getting punished for it.
Yeah, Coreboy's actually holding this pretty well right now. I mean, they crumbled a little bit on the, you know, just defending the waypoint, but now that they're here, they're doing pretty well. Okay, now we've got A planted. This is a very, very long hallway, so a lot of the longer range suits, you know, Jim Sniper is so good at defending. You can defend all the way almost from spawn, from the waypoint spawn. And you can see, you know, well, actually, that's going to be it. Yeah, I just needed the one tick. I immediately forgot how quick that was going to go, but that's all it takes. And that's tough right there. You know, they have to have already basically been there when it was planted to get the, like, basically a full team wipe and then just stop them from even getting a single tick. Very, very difficult, but they held pretty well, honestly. I do have to say they held pretty well in that second phase there.
Yeah, Bozos did an amazing job on their first point hold, essentially, basically not letting them out of their spawn. But they did an amazing job, I would say, for the Bozos side of, like, giving up height. You can see what happens when you kind of staunchly try and defend that. They had three members up there for the Koi Boys on their defense, and eventually you saw that defense getting picked apart. Duke going in, doing a massive amount of damage, getting him down to about 100 HP, leaving him essentially one shot on that Methus. And then that's where the kind of dominoes fell on that defensive side for the Koi Boys. So, amazing first map for the Bozos. By the way, we were talking about the bans. It was supposed to be first map Blackfort. I don't know what happened. We went to Quarry there, so we're going to figure things out in just a moment there. Admins are going to do that. After first map, we're going to have our next pick, of course, as well. We'll find out what that is in just a moment. But we were talking about it before this map, right? Like, why you kind of want to stay away from our domination map points, and especially for some of our teams that are going up against Bozos. I think just the simple kind of pressure that Duke can put out on his own as that flanker, as that Exia, that might just be the simple reason why you don't want to play domination.
Yeah, I would certainly not want to play domination against Duke. That is probably one of the scariest things you could possibly run into. And the rest of the team does seem pretty flexible. We didn't see too much of a change. We saw them here change, but just their comp in general, it's not super committed to one play style or another. So I think they could do really well on domination. Obviously, they just did really well on destruction, but I totally agree with that. I would just simply stay away from that mode. And, you know, you were talking about how if it was Blackfort, how Jim Sniper could have been a really good pick. Jim Sniper can be, of course, a good pick on that first point there as well on Quarry, but there are a lot more walls that block line of sights. There are multiple different ways that you can go through. So we did see Koi Boys go for the sniper on defense in that second round, and you saw that, like, by the time it was really being able to pick anything off, we had the Exia throwing some shots at it. It was standing on, like, that weird spot kind of above the checkpoint, and it just wasn't able to get as much mileage. So I think if they have a player that wants to play Jim Sniper there, we're probably going to see them try to go to other maps that have long sight points, because that's one where I could see you kind of, like, dropping off that and going for something a little bit more mid-range, like maybe even just a normal Gundam.
Yeah, underground command center point A is another one where you're going to see a lot of Jim Sniper, right? You got the hills on the outside just before the waypoint where teams have a lot more space to work with, but again, it is also kind of the Exia's playground as well. Yeah. So you kind of, you have to be able to play both styles ultimately in the end. You did see right now, it does seem like we do have the same Exia. I think it's going to be basically 100% pick rate throughout. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we did see some flexibility in terms of support. We had Gundam for the side of, Unicorn for the side of the Bozos, and then we had the Methus coming out from the Koi Boys. So it does seem like, you know, a lot of comfort picks coming around for other teams. I think the Bozos, when it came to their defense there on Quarry, did an amazing job. Again, they didn't have that single target heal, but what they were able to rely upon was having that health pack right there. You saw that they were pretty bunched up on their defense on that left-hand side, playing that single pack. It's a small health pack, of course. Doesn't heal you to full, but when you do have the Dom with the extra armor along with the Unicorn with the passive armor healing overall, you're going to be able to play that one out expertly, and that's what they were able to do. Being able to utilize that well. Right now, I'm just waiting for production to see what we have for the map bans or the map picks for the next one. That was our first one in our best of three. So the Koi Boys win the next series. They'll be moving on to the winner's semifinals. So let's go ahead and check out the map bans for now to see, the map pool for now to see what we have coming up next. So Quarry was already played for map number one. We had Ministry of Defense and Thermal Plant banned out. Now we're just waiting for map number two pick.
Yeah, so I see, I mean, just looking at the maps that we have left, right? We've got two very, very opposite maps between Mountain R&D Lab, which is one of the, I want to say, like, flankiest maps that you can possibly get in the game, of course, it being a domination map. We do see, wait, Flakfort is now highlighted as map number two, so maybe now they're going back to Flakfort.
Okay, Flakfort. I think the interesting thing for this one is that if there is a pick, if you're able to find a pick with that GM sniper on the offense, the run back is so incredibly long, 4.A, when it comes to Flakfort. So being able to really slow things down. Once you find that initial pick, you don't have to kind of rush in. You can slow things down, find that first pick, and then slowly work your way up that hill or across that bridge. So this is going to come down to all patience, and I think at this point for our teams, to really be able to utilize that and kind of not get carried away by picks. You can see, you know, when it comes to like the beginning of scenes or like teams that don't come as well, that sometimes they get carried away by their own momentum, and then you can see teams instantly be able to turn things around. I think Gundam is one of those games because there aren't as many heals that teams can turn around fights. 4v6s all the time, I see them getting turned around. So you have to be careful about not getting your own momentum carried away. Want to shout out Gundam Evolution for showing up for this. Thank you so much, guys. That is the official Gundam Evolution channel popping up to support us here. Thank you all so much. We love your game. Thank you so much for allowing us to do this.
Yeah, this is all. I love this game so much. And I love seeing the play, especially like, I mean, getting to see the Axie from Duke. I mean, this is what I wanted to see, right? I am I'm definitely not on the level of these players, but I can appreciate it so much. And I mean, this is going to be such good footage if you're trying to get better at the game. That's what I'm most excited for, is that we get a chance to, you know, be able to teach people how to improve, because it's a fresh scene, right? I'm glad that we have so many players here. I mean, technically we've got over 60 players within the bracket, just looking at actual player numbers. And there's a lot of players that I'm sure are very interested in, like, oh, this game looks really cool. Like, maybe I'll try it out, but I don't quite have a team yet. I'm not sure if I'm really competent enough with one particular suit yet to try and join a team. And I think this is going to be a great spot for them to try and figure out. But it does look like we are here going into game number two. And we're seeing, like you said, that long run back from spawn for the defenders here. We're going to actually have two flyers on the side of the defenders.
That one is interesting. On the defensive side for the Koi Boys, bringing in the Methus along with the Ashtamar, my idea is like maybe to make the run back a little bit shorter, but if you think you're already going to die, but I mean, Ashtamar with the Molly basically can be strong. There are basically three entryways into point eight right now. You can see the first one on the right-hand screen of the Methus, and then just behind that wall, there's another flanking angle. You can see two entrances there and then one just below. So trying to control all of these could be a play. I think you might have maybe more value coming out from maybe a Dom, but hey, the point has opened up and now it's going to be the Bozos on the offense pushing forward. You can see why teams play inside of point A instead of maybe playing off that bridge. It's just a free pick if you decide to try and play out there for a GM sniper.
Yeah, it's for anybody out there who is maybe just playing in ranked or playing in casual matches, try not to push really far forward and hold really far forward points. This is not the game for that. The spawns are right next to the first points. It's very easy for you to get picked. The run backs are huge and it can just be a nightmare situation. You just immediately set your team up into a tough spot. So this is one of those maps where you do see a ton of people that are usually holding way too far forward. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like I can see the game personally myself.
It does seem like the push has already happened. Methus is on the run back right now, so it was just a quick push. So they will have to defend for point B at this point. Again, point B is another one where maybe you hold a little bit forward as the point just gets captured by the Bozos. For the time being, though, you can see Methus trying to hold up a little bit further forward, but we saw how they got punished by Duke, and he's got to be careful. Once again, he's trying to play around on walls, use that repair cable from behind to just keep his team topped off. They do find one pick, and there's going to be a second one here. So the Ashtamar finding some value for his squad for the time being. They're going to force them back. But again, they have so much time to work with. What, 9-8 minutes here to just try and capture point B?
Yeah, this can be a really tough map regardless, just on offense. It's really interesting because this is one of the, I think, most commonly taken first points on offense, but the second point, it has so many different angles that people can hold defense from. So it'll be interesting to see just what spots they decide to hold, how far forward they decide to hold. But it does look like we're seeing some fighting kind of within that main spot. Oh, we're going to get our feedback. I'm super excited.
I was watching off of Lux's monitor.
I was too. I was as well.
Yeah, we're going to have our feed in just a moment. But there were some picks coming out from from the Bozos, and now they are starting to make their way on to a point. It does seem like as Methus gets back in time to try and hold things down, but he is forced back again. 800 HP is not much on the supports. And if you take one shot, even one Dom body, you're basically out of that fight and you have to fall back.
Yeah, that's one thing about the team that Koi Boys is running is they actually have an extremely low HP team. They do have the technical armor of the Unicorn, but overall in their team, nobody is really that tanky. They've got one shield unit, and actually, you can see how squishy they are as they are entirely going down. We see the team kill, or almost one away from a team kill, but already we are three ticks into capturing point B. And this is going to be very hard to defend. It looks like they're going for a pick a little bit far off of the point, actually. It looks like this might be it. Yeah, we've got the Unicorn ult. That could be a really, really good option for defense. Of course, that's going to be holding for a little bit. Didn't quite get the picks it needed to, I think. And that is going to be another team kill into a very quick round one.
When you have like an open map like this, he's able to fly around, get everything done. But they were able to clearly just finish him off. The G maneuver goes down. Maybe he got it off for a second, 2 seconds, but really got no value off of it because he was instantly sniped. We didn't really get to talk about the offensive picks, but we did have the Methus coming in for the Bozos on their offense. And so that kind of signals to me they're going to try and run a very similar composition when it does come to their defense as well.
Yeah, I think I accidentally said Unicorn G maneuver, but yeah, I definitely meant turn A. I was going to mention that earlier on defense. The turn A, a really interesting pick. I do know that we tend to see it a decent amount when we have a lot of melee units that it can kind of grab. Of course, it does do a lot of damage from a range, and it does have that extremely powerful G maneuver, but the problem is it only works once, right? So if you're depending on that G maneuver, you're not going to hold for that much longer than that one particular push. It takes quite a while to charge. Now, looking at this comp, we see the turn A as well, but we're actually going to see, I think, our first Zaku 2 ranged of the day, and that's a suit that I personally love a lot. That's actually the suit that made me fall in love with this game, because that movement is so fun.
Yeah, he is, of course, classed with like the triple dash units, but the thing is, I think a lot of people don't quite realize is that his dashes are actually longer than the other triple dash units, so you get a lot more value for it. You have to, of course, play extremely close. Now, taking a look at the defensive side right now for the Bozos, they are actually playing this one a little bit more aggressively than what we saw coming out from the Koi Boys, where they were just holed up inside of point A. For the Bozos, though, they will try their hand just a bit, waiting things out.
Yeah, they do have a... we see the Sazabi, of course, which we're seeing kind of holding a door, which is a great spot for this, right? If you can hold a small choke point with Sazabi, it is extremely valuable.
Now, we do have that push onto point A right now, as the Koi Boys have already secured one tick. They're trying to finish off the rest of the team, but you can see that Pale Rider down below. So that's going to be the reset coming out from the Koi Boys. So it's about bending and not breaking on the defense here for the Bozos. They give up a tick, and that's fine. That's just point A. Remember, they had, what, maybe 6 minutes left on their timer on the other side. And so it's all about just trying to wait things out. Now, we do have the reset coming out, and here comes the first push. But it's going to be Halloween Havoc getting that first kill. We see the...
Technically, they're kind of all Halloween Havoc kills.
Yeah.
even though it's not even Halloween anymore. But you know what? Halloween ends when we decide that it's going to end. But yeah, I actually really like the angles that Koi Boys are pushing in on offense. They are getting some nice picks. They are playing this really well. And I haven't really seen if... Oh, actually, we already see the switch off of the Zaku. That was extremely quick. I was really excited to see Zaku. Come on. Big Zaku fan here. But yeah, I understand. There are honestly... The weirdest thing to me is that we're not seeing the Exia.
Yeah, the difficult thing, I think, for that Zaku 2 range, especially trying to get onto point A, is just the simple fact is that take a look at the defensive setup coming out from them. They got the Pale Rider for the Bozos up top, but they are covering every single angle. So it becomes very difficult for the Zaku to try and get to the back range. Ooh, the Sazabi tries to go in, but does get interrupted there, drops down to 200 HP as he backs away. The Hades will be called down by that Pale Rider. And it's going to be another cleanup coming out from the Bozos, forcing them back. 2 minutes and 30 seconds left on the clock, and they've only gotten the one tick onto point A.
Yeah, this is looking to be, I mean, again, you know, it's, they're definitely not going out without a fight. And I do have to point out again, I think Bozos are very much, just from what we've seen them, from them in now two tournaments or a tournament in one game, potentially one of the best teams, at least within the region, at the very, very minimum within the region. But obviously, you know, having one of the, having literally the rank one player on their team amongst the, you know, similar talent is extremely impressive. But they're doing well, really. The Coldboys are doing extremely well. I did read again that they're a new, a little bit of a newer team. They don't have as much tournament experience as I know their first tournament together as an actual squad, and you know they get a tick. They've gotten, you know, some holds. Right now, though, oh yeah, you cannot use that flight like that against a Pale Rider that can aim. Pale Rider, that DPS is just so good against flyers.
Yeah, now they're feeling a lot more comfortable to push out. Maybe try and find an extra pick, find that stagger. But we're basically down to two more pushes left for the Koi Boys here. You can see, once again, Pale Rider is going to be that defensive last line, holding on that high ground the entire time. They do have a little bit of presence on the bridge. Once again, it's just about bending, not breaking, figuring out where that push is coming from. And now they're going to try a two-point attack, but the Sazabi has been caught out. That Ashmar burn going down. The Methus will try and go for the heal, but he will get finished off. Now it's going to be Jay Slay actually isolating the Sazabi of their own, but the Dom comes in from behind, picks up two. Sazabi's going to be on that long run back, but it's fine, as it's a beautiful hold so far, coming back, forcing them back onto the bridge. And the Koi Boys will now have only 1 minute remaining here. They still need to get point A.
Yeah, this Pale Rider has put in so much work. You can see that even from far away, even after the damage drop off. Like you mentioned, you know, there's damage drop off. It's not the the worst damage drop off of, you know, any shooter. And especially if you're getting criticals, aka headshots, the damage fall off seems to be like a smaller percentage than it would have been normally. So you can get some really far away melts, especially if you've got aim like this. But yeah, okay, one pick. That's huge. This really needs to be their push. I mean, only 30 seconds left.
Ashamar punch and the funnel coming out now for the G maneuvers on the defensive side. Once again, Pale Rider changes up his position this time, but Sazabi is isolated on his own, dropping down extremely low. He will find that first pick, taking out the turn A, trading back, and now as they charge forward, they're going to try and get their Sazabi back on up in just a moment. Never mind, they're going to leave him there to go down. But it looks like the hold might just be enough. Is there going to be enough time for the run back here? No! That's going to be map two, going the way of the Bozos. Clean sweep in this 2-0 in our winner's quarterfinals.
Yeah, so well played by Bozos. I am extremely impressed. I'm glad that we get to see a team of that caliber in the very first game, and I would love to see, you know, teams like the Koi Boys make their first kind of foray to this competitive scene. Like, again, I want to say they played very, very well. They went up against potentially the strongest competitor in this bracket, or one of the top ones easily. And the, you know, as a first step into a tournament, especially in team games, a lot of it is just getting that experience, getting that ability to communicate with your team and gel together and not have to communicate in certain situations. And it looks like they took a really far step forward in that. So we got to see some great play and we got to see some new names. So that's exactly what I wanted to see out of all of this. My big surprise, though, after everything that we said about Jim Sniper, we didn't see it there. We didn't see it there. Even though they used it in the previous map, we did not see it at point A there. I'm surprised.
Well, again, I think for Flag Ford, it's kind of just like, maybe you open up with it, right? It's not something you run with. You don't run to point B. You can if your Gym Sniper is really good, extremely good. But you can see that either side, we're doing a great job of kind of avoiding those sight lines, right? Sometimes you just don't play into the Sniper. And so it's a quick swap off. They went back. We did see Pale Rider coming out. So right now, we do kind of have our standards. Pale Rider, Dom, things like that. And I think right now, currently for the meta, it's nice to have Melee Zaku out, because if we had Melee Zaku, we might be just seeing Melee Zaku, Unicorn, Dom, Pale Rider, and that would be kind of like the four core, four compositions. Having Melee Zaku out right now leaves things a little bit more open, so I'm glad that we do currently have that. But congratulations once again to Bozos. They will be moving on to our winner's finals, and that does mean that we're going to have Bozos versus Inari Zaki going on in the winner's semifinals after this.